in the process of national apprehension, and it was marked by the first beginnings of a spy hunt, by the first denunciation of naturalized aliens, and by some anti-German rioting among the mixed alien population in the East End. Most of the bakers in the East End of London were Germans, and for some months after the war began, they went on with their trade unmolested. Now, many of these shops were wrecked. It was only in October that the British gave these first signs of a sense that they were fighting not merely political Germany, but the Germans. But the idea of a peculiar malignity in the German quality as a key to the broad issue of the war was even less satisfactory and less permanent in Mr. Britling's mind than his first crude opposition of militarism and a peaceful humanity as embodied respectively in the Central Powers and the Russo-Western Alliance. It led logically to the conclusion that the extermination of the German peoples was the only security for the general amiability of the world, a conclusion that appealed but weakly to his essential kindliness. After all, the Germans he had met and seen were neither cruel nor hate-inspired. He came back to that obstinately. From the harshness and vileness of the printed word and the unclean picture, he fell back upon the flesh and blood, the humanity and sterling worth of, as a sample, young Heinrich, who was, moreover, a thoroughly German young German, a thoroughly Prussian young Prussian. At times, young Heinrich alone stood between Mr. Britling and the belief that Germany and the whole German race was essentially wicked, essentially a canting robber nation. Young Heinrich became a sort of advocate for his people.